I have time till 3:20, yes? Till 3:20, I have time. Yeah, yes? Okay. Thank you. My name is Ilya Sibgatulin. I'm from Moscow State University. Also, I collaborate with the Institute of System Programming, ENS de Lyon, in France, with Laboratoire de Physique, the École Normale Supérieure. Also with the Institute of Oceanology in Russia and Lavrentiev Institute of Hydrodynamics in Novosibirsk with Evgeny Ermanyuk. I will show my courses later in the presentation. So it will be about gravity waves, but not surface gravity waves. I will, like you can see obviously on the surface of the sea. But the waves which propagate inside the continuously stratified media. So if a stratified, if you have a layer which is stratified, in case if density grows with height, we will obviously have convection. Otherwise, it will be asymptotically stable because with time it will, in presence of viscosity, any perturbation will go close to zero, but this case is also very interesting because there may propagate the waves. They are called internal waves, and from the simple consideration, you can see that frequency of proper frequency is equal to square root of the equation of oscillator, like it is written here. It is called frequency of Brunt-Weissala or buoyancy frequency. This is all well-known things. I will just show you the example of internal waves, which are, this is a picture of an experiment, and you have a cylinder which oscillates, and you have internal waves which propagate obliquely, so they're inclined vertical. And they, from this picture, you can see also that they can reflect from the surfaces. Here is how it is important in nature, but I will just skip it and go directly to the problem which we, first problem which we studied. We studied propagation of internal waves in special kind of geometries experimentally and numerically. My part is numerical, direct numerical simulation. So we solved full Navier-Stokes equations in Boussinesq approximation. And Boussinesq approximation works very well in these conditions. Here I just remind linear theory. And from linear theory, you can see that frequency and wave a wave vector are connected just by this equation. So frequency doesn't depend on the length of the wave vector, only on the its direction. This is very, very peculiar to internal waves, and because of this, we will see absolutely astonishing, from my point of view, results. The fact that after the reflection from the inclined walls, the internal waves conserve the angle with vertical direction is well known from ancient times already. Phillips, Gabo Svechnikov in 70s, 80s wrote about that. But interestingly, that only in 1995-96 by Leo Maas, it was discovered that in some kind of geometries, he tried many kinds of geometries actually, but it happened out that very simple geometry, just trapezoidal, if you put inside a source of monochromatic wave, so for example a cylinder oscillating, the waves after some reflection, some number of reflection, actually will tend to be on some kind of trajectory. This trajectory was called, this path was called a wave attractor. In this case, internal wave attractor. So here there are pioneering works of Leo Maas in 1995-1997. And so what we did now, conventional linear theory is well developed, and what is most interesting now is nonlinear effects of this phenomena. So actually what we solved is numerically is Navier-Stokes equations. This is the experimental facility, which is located in ENS École Normale Supérieure de Lyon, in the Laboratoire de Physique. So they put, with the help of two bucket techniques, they create a stably stratified aquarium, tank of salted water. The dimensions here is the height in this particular experiment was about 30 centimeters. Also, there is a, another experimental facility with height 1 meter and different width. And here on the left side, you can see the, on the left here, you can see wave maker. So it consists of 50 eccentric plates which are moving. So it's quite a complicated experimental stuff. I will not stop on this now. Here just several of the papers devoted to study of wave attractors. But the problem with numerical simulation was that here we had we have a high Schmidt number. High Schmidt number already was mentioned just before yesterday that high Schmidt number actually induce the characteristics of turbulence become much more complicated, and here we will see it also. And from the point of numerical point of view, you have to not to resolve Kolmogorov scale, but much a smaller scale if you go to turbulent regime. So these are experimental results. It's amplitude of velocity field. So you understand that here there is no motion of a fluid from one part to another. It is wave motion. So every particle of a fluid just oscillating about its initial position somehow. So this is, if you will, draw in each point time dependence of some characteristic, for example, velocity, you will have such a picture. And this picture will differ in different points only by amplitude. So here we show, with the help of Hilbert transform, the amplitude of this field. And you see clearly that most of the energy concentrates of the first branch of the attractor. It is called the first branch. So here is some details of numerical simulation, because as I said, it is quite challenging for modeling turbulence because of small scale structures which can appear in the boundary layers. And also we need to make numerical simulation for a long time and account for nonlinear interaction. So we use a high order approach, and in this case it's a spectral element approach, and with we modified code by NEC 5000 by Paul Fischer, and use it finally very efficiently. It is a structure of one finite element in a spectral element approach. So this is one of my first simulation. You can see, so this is already numerical simulation. The left wall begins to move. And after some time, you see that actually attractor is formed with the color. Color corresponds to a component of velocity, horizontal component of velocity. Oh, yes. And arrows just the direction of the velocity, because it would not be reasonable to draw the length, otherwise you would see nothing. But you see that actually it's moving like this. So the wave propagates like this, and the transversal wave, particle in the wave move like this. And we studied lots of things about that, but I will point out now only the major facts. Is so on the left side, you can see a distribution just of density, so salinity. And on the right-hand side, component of velocity, or it may be also the same absolutely picture for the density gradient, for example, d rho over dx. So you can see here that it is not just optical effect. You can see quite clearly, even on the left-hand side, that something is going on in the fluid. And on the right-hand side, you can see that first attractor is formed, and then it becomes unstable, because now we have larger input, larger external forcing. So actually, you can see almost turbulent motion. And the first thing which we have done is we analyzed this with the help of Hilbert transform. So we could separate the phase and amplitude, and we to prove the fact that actually equations for triadic resonance are fulfilled here. So this for this we constructed a time frequency diagram. So first you will see only external frequency, no, just the frequency of the external forcing. But later there appear daughter waves. So this is instability, it's a triadic resonance. We have studied it in details in 3D simulations also, and unstable also unstable case. And for the first time, we finally obtained very good comparison between experiment and numerical simulation, because before the discrepancy between numerical simulation and in previous tries, for example, in 1888 in Journal of Fluid Mechanics, there was very good paper, but they couldn't and they reproduced numerically in two-dimensional simulation attractor, but by characteristics it differed almost twice. So here the effect of the wall happened to be quite important. It's like a Stokes layer, and we studied it effects in details. After that, we had actually received this. We went to the Brasserie Georges in Lyon. So these are my co-authors, Thierry Duxois, Director de Laboratoire de Physique de Lyon, and Evgeny Romanyuk. It's Roberto Camassa just was there also. Okay. So we published this paper about this, Journal of Fluid Mechanics and Europhysics Letters. And just now we submitted a paper with Felix Bekibanze concerning the effect of the lateral walls, which also may be important for geophysical applications. So here you can see the appearance of the instability on the attractor, internal wave attractors. Here it's how it looks like if you consider time tie dependence of a variable on the branch of the attractor. And here is the time frequency diagram, one of which is experimental, one of them is numerical. And from my point of view, it's even difficult to say which one is DNS, which one is numerical. I will now go to the next representation of the internal wave attractors. We can study them with the so-called spectra. So on both axes you have frequency, and by color you can represent a quantity proportional to a product of the amplitudes. In this case, if you can clearly see here that here we have triadic resonance, because if we will sum this value on horizontal axis plus value on vertical axis, it will lie on the anti-diagonal only if omega 1 plus omega 2 is equal to omega 0. And in such a way, if the external forcing is very intensive, we will have cascade of instabilities. So here we can see that we have cascade of triadic resonances. So first, the external forcing produce the two major daughter waves, but these daughter waves also become unstable and produce also daughter waves and so on. So we have cascade, and we have finally the spectrum, which is spiky, which has many lines on the background of some continuous spectrum. So here we how we investigate this, and also what is what was important for us is to investigate the distribution of vorticity, because there is a criterion Miles-Hovert. If vorticity is higher than a certain value, vorticity divided by Brunt-Weissauer frequency, if it is higher than 2, then there is a probability of overturning of a particle. Overturning means intensive mixing. So we studied experimentally and numerically, actually, here, for example, for some time we have a probability density function of vorticity in the whole domain, which, and these branches, these left and right arms, they go beyond 2. So it means that there may be mixing, overturning, and intensive mixing. So we have studied this. This is from experiments. So for different amplitudes, we have different regimes. And also, I will not go into details of this picture, just what it means. It means that we have a cascade of wave instabilities. And also, of course, we get longer waves and shorter waves. So shorter waves are more prone to overturn if they have a higher amplitude. So this is what it actually it shows. But I will not stop on this. I'm sorry for rushing here. But just to say that we studied it. Also, now I will show you the importance of the account of high Schmidt number. For the laboratory. Here we have a large amplitude of the oscillation of the left wall. And with time, you see that in contrast to the previous simulation, there appear very small structures. Because here the Schmidt number is 700. First, I thought that it is some numerical stuff. But actually, yes, actually what we have these small scale structures which propagate inside the area, and we have such picture much more small scaled. But anyway, if you will filter it on the external forcing, you will get attractor. So it is moving, but very, very stochastically, turbulently, but anyway, there is an attractor structure in this simulation. So what next I would mention is that if on, you will oscillate not all the left wall, but only a small part of it, here just I didn't draw the inclined wall, but as before, it is a trapezoidal domain. You see here that after some time, actually, you have, again, almost two-dimensional attractor. This is amazing to my point of view, because from the local source, if you will just drop a stone to the water, of course, you will have cylindrical waves. But here you have a localized source just near zero, but you don't have cylindrical waves around it, or some kind of with cylindrical symmetry, but you have almost two-dimensional attractor, and two-dimensionality we analyzed with the help of correlation functions. So this is what we are working now. And the next thing, I will switch to another topic. but related with internal waves, not to waves attractors, not internal waves. So we will consider now experiment with rotating homogeneous fluid. So now there is no stratification, only rotating annulus. So it is like it is a vertical cross section, and it's it is axially symmetrical. It has a rotation, and upper surface on upper surface we impose some forcing. So in this case, I will now switch to another. So for this, there is a construction of experimental facility also in Lyon. I will not comment it. I will only now show the results. And just a second. So so this work we are doing now with Evgeny Romaniuk, Thierry Duxois. He doesn't know yet about all the details of this. And Xuk Xulini, it's a postgraduate student in Moscow University. So we have such if we will cut this for the depth Z minus 15, you will get such a picture. So actually nothing especially interesting, just some presence of internal waves. So this is not this is not something special. Next, we will do in the opposite direction. Okay, so first we moved the upper surface like a precession in the same direction as the rotation. But if you will make it in opposite direction, see, you can see clearly that there are regions of accumulation of energy. So here you have it very clearly. It's in a Yang picture from Chinese philosophy. And if you will cut it vertically, you will finally have very, very nice attractors. So you can see that they are in counter phase, the left and right sides. But yes, you got the attractor in rotating absolutely homogeneous fluids. Also, we studied different cases, and also for libration, we by libration maybe it's not very correct word, but I mean that if you just make a vibration of the upper surface, it not moves like this as an effect of tidal effect, but just vibrate in the in the frame of reference, rotating frame of reference. You will also have the internal wave attractor. So these are completely new results, and actually this is the first conference we presented, and we are working now on publishing this. So this is completely new, and for the first time it is presented on any conference here. So thank you very much. Okay. Yes, yes, of course it will. There are actually a number of problems which are very interesting. Yes, it's combining combining internal waves and inertial waves, and also studying it in a much longer geometries, and to compare it to Miles and Howard to spectrum, I just forgot the names because, but Garrett Munk, yes, which is known in oceanography. So, and also there may be attractors of different forms which multiply reflects from the sides. So, yes, here it's plenty.
So, you can superimpose two attractors?
It would be interesting. We haven't done this. The first, what we will do is biharmonic, which is this corresponds geophysically and astrophysically to situations with tidal excitation. For example, in this situation, you have a loon which is rotating around a planet or some object, and if it rotates in one direction, there will be nothing, just some internal waves. But in another direction, you will finally got at, yes? Oh, okay. So, just to show this, you will, you will, what you will have, yes, here, just a second, excuse me. No. Sure. I'm sorry it wasn't here, but okay. Sorry, I haven't prepared, but instability here looks very, very impressive. If you want, I can show you. It's just on a different video.
Excuse me.
Yes. Okay. Thank you.